Thank you, thank you, thank you very much. And welcome to Cats and Dogs with me, Lembit Hopik, here on Press TV. This week we explore the strange world of alleged sexual misdemeanours, from the Royal Air Force to distant relatives of the royal family. Let's start with Britain's Air Defence Military Power, the RAF. As you may know, the British Royal Air Force is investigating an offensive video in which troops reportedly appeared to sexually assault an airman in an initiation ritual. My friends, we are living in a really strange era. Soccer players become actors like Eric Cantona. Actors become scientists like Sharon Stone. Scientists become space-age businessmen like Elon Musk. Businessmen become presidents like Donald Trump. And now military personnel have got into the triple X movie business. Dare I take a sneaky look with you at the seeable part of this video? Some say such behaviour runs through the whole of the British establishment, whether it's the Royal Air Force or the outer limits of the royal family. And it's true. A very distant cousin of the Queen recently pleaded guilty to sexually assaulting a woman in his ancestral home, Glamis Castle in Scotland. Apparently, the Earl of Strathmore, that Simon Bowis Lyon, forced his way into the sleeping women's room during a weekend event he was hosting, and he did some very bad things then. The whole story sounds like something from the Middle Ages. A gloomy castle furnished with dungeons, underground passages, and sliding panels. An unsuspecting damsel attacked by a cruel and lustful villain. The title could be something from Harry Potter, like The Innocent, The Errant Earl, and The Castle of Doom. Well, he pleaded guilty. And his sentence? He's not in prison. He's not even under house arrest. No, ladies and gentlemen, the Earl of Strathmore is officially under castle arrest. That's right. What a punishment for a sex offender. Unless, of course, the castle belongs to Count Dracula or Dr. Frankenstein, but it doesn't. It's his. They haven't even made it compulsory to make the Earl watch Scotland lose at rugby on television. Basically, his punishment is to spend the rest of lockdown like the rest of us, except that his royal horniness is living in the Scottish equivalent of Hogwarts from Harry Potter. Perhaps the treatment of the Earl is what Nicola Sturgeon, Alex Salmond's de facto enemy, had in mind for her First Minister predecessor. Get Alex prosecuted and stick him in a dungeon. Forever. Or until Scotland becomes independent, which could also take forever. So all of this is to say that the main problem faced by distant relatives of the royal family and former friends of the Scottish First Minister isn't Brexit. It's not social welfare. It's not student debt. It's not even the coronavirus pandemic or homelessness. It's feeling frisky. It's basically horniness. Now, here's the question. Could it be that as a direct result of the right royal mayhem at the castle, where the Queen Mother herself actually grew up, Meghan Markle is now under pressure by the royal family for her love of steamy scenes?
We found a blue contact near Grant Jordan's body. Now, if the prescription were to match yours...
All right, I was with Grant in the swim gym.
And is that type of service part of the job description?
Well, that depends on if you want to stay employed.
When was the last time you two went for a swim?
I guess about 3 days ago. And then he fired me the next morning. And I packed my stuff and I left. Look, I may have slept with Grant Jordan, but I didn't kill him.
All right, then you won't mind giving us one of your contacts as a reference sample?
Did not suit the British royal family and therefore had to be expelled. But if the criterion for remaining in the palace is a super high standard of moral decency, the Queen and her husband might be the only people who end up living in Buckingham Palace all alone. That's worse than castle arrest in Scotland as a punishment. I mean, how is Her Royal Highness going to vacuum so many rooms or wash all those windows? And have you seen the size of the lawn? You don't know all that in a Saturday afternoon. Anyway, let's get back to the British Army, the second biggest employer in the country, where sexual assault and wrongdoing is so widespread. Do all roads lead to rape? No, but one of the military's goals is to keep its personnel in tip-top fighting form. Having said that, treating the opposite sex as the hypothetical enemy and attacking them isn't an ideal form of drill training, is it? An investigation by UN Women UK claimed almost all young women in the UK have been sexually harassed. By almost, I mean 97%. And by young, I mean between 18 and 24 years old. My only complaint about that is that I classify young these days as anyone under the age of 56. Actually, forget that. Incidentally, according to International Knowledge Network of Women in Politics, almost all of Israel's 32 women in parliament, to be exact, 28 of them, have been sexually harassed or assaulted, and two of them inside the Knesset itself. But if you think sexual assault is a white-collar crime in Israel, you're totally wrong. Sexual violence has increased by 91% in the Israeli army over the past 5 years. 40% of the cases have occurred in non-military zones and 60% in military zones, which means that military personnel in action against a perceived enemy seem to still have the time to get into action against their own colleagues. As I said, it's a mad, mad world. Meanwhile, the authorities in Belgium have said that in certain places in Brussels, almost 80% of women no longer dare to come out for fear of sexual harassment. Is that right? Yes, it is. 80% of women are in voluntary lockdown, and not because of the COVID pandemic, but because of this other pandemic of sexual harassment. The obvious question is, who are the other 20% of women who do dare to go out? Brussels police have launched a project to dispatch plainclothes police officers to tackle the issue of sexual harassment on the streets. That could work there, but that's because, unlike in the UK, they don't have to find castles for high-ranking sexual offenders to live in during their sentence. Things look better in France, where COVID-19 lockdown has sparked a big drop in the number of reported crimes in the country over the past year, except for domestic violence and rape cases, which continue to rise. So the problem there is the opposite of Belgium. The way they reported it, it made it sound like you're safer walking around outside than you are in your home. On the other side of the world, Australia's Attorney General Christian Porter is fighting accusations of rape allegations. He seems very sad about what he says he hasn't done.
I can say categorically that what has been put in various forms in allegations simply did not happen.
Now, nothing has been proved in the Australia case, so don't try to sue me. I've got friends in high places, and almost none of them live in castles. Incidentally, in a strange case, Finnish Green MEP Elvina Almester, who became an MEP in January after an additional seat was allocated to Finland following Brexit, says she has already been belittled, discriminated against, and sexually harassed since becoming an MEP. It shows that when it comes to discrimination, nobody is discriminating against new politicians. We didn't deal with the sexual assault cases in the US Army because this show is around 10 minutes, not 10 months long. But here's a clip from an American soldier.
So we went to New York City, hung out at the Army and Navy hotel. I end up passing out, waking up with somebody tugging my pants off and another person standing above me ejaculating on my face. And the one that was trying to pull my pants off was trying to grab at my jowls. And I freaked out. I didn't know it was, wow.
Oscar Wilde writes in The Picture of Dorian Gray, published in 1891, that's 130 years ago, "The only way to get rid of a temptation is to yield to it." Now, after 130 years, Norway has maybe found a solution to all of this. In the Norwegian army, men and women fight together and sleep together in unisex dorms. It's a bold experiment, but it's clever too. The thing is, they can afford to risk it, firstly, because no one really very often invades Norway, and secondly, because it's so cold up there, the only way you can stay warm in the field of conflict is to share a bed. It's time to see who's good, who's bad, and who's ugly. The good this week is the Cuban Ministry of Health that's managed to become a medical hub despite all US sanctions. By producing 100 million vaccine doses, the country is going to be the first to inoculate all its people free of charge. Now Cuba is going to export vaccines to the whole world. In fact, if the United States weren't so busy imposing sanctions on Iran and messing with Myanmar's internal affairs, it could well put sanctions on Cuba's vaccines of mass convalescence. The bad this week is Tanzania's president, who denied the existence of the virus for months and therefore did nothing for the non-existent pandemic in his country. Then he tested positive for COVID-19. If he had tested positive a few months earlier, maybe he'd have been the good guy of the week. But you snooze, you lose. And the ugly this week is the United States of America. It's announced it has no plan to share its COVID vaccines with Mexico and Canada after being paid to do so. Backtracking Biden has made U-turns his trademark. If I were Canada and Mexico, I'd be so angry I'd do anything to keep those pesky Americans out, like building a wall. That's it for this week. Thanks for joining, and join me again next time to see who's arresting the distribution of vaccines, who's resting with whom in the Norwegian army, and who's under house arrest in a castle. That's all on Press TV with me, Lembitovic, right here on Cats and Dogs.